Well, good morning. Welcome to our Sunday morning worship experience here on video from Cornerstone Baptist Church. I'm Rick Byrd. I'm the pastor here at Cornerstone. And it is my joy to open up our service this morning with a word of prayer. In just a moment, our band is going to lead us in some worship songs, and then we're going to get into God's Word as we continue in our series in the book of Galatians. We actually are coming to the end of this great letter. This morning, we're going to concentrate on verses 11 through 14 and talking about the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ and how Paul reminds us that that should be the only thing that we boast about. Well, let's have a word of prayer and we'll get started this morning. Bow with me if you will. Father, we thank you for this time of worship. God, our prayer is that you be honored and glorified through our worship and praise this morning. And we just want to say how much we love you and how much we appreciate everything that you continue to do in our lives. And Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You lay down your life. earth you formed was not your home. A love like this the world had never known. A crown of thorns to mark your name. Forgiveness fell upon your face. A love like this the world. Let there be no higher name, Jesus, Son of God. You laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. You're Jesus, Son of God. On the altar of our praise, let there be no higher name. Jesus, Son of God, you laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. You're Jesus, Son.
Can come against your love. The cross
songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. I was lost in utter darkness till you came and rescued me. I was bound by all my sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone. Come now, found, come now, King. Come now, precious Prince of Peace. Hear your bride, to you we sing. Come now, fount of our blessing. Thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy coats above.
Let's have a moment of giving our tithes and offerings as an act of worship, as we usually do. You can give online by clicking the link below this video, by visiting cornerstonegso.org, or by texting the word GIVE to 336-565-7577. If giving online is more of a nuisance than a convenience for you, you can always mail a check. Please contact Cindy in our church office, and she will gladly answer any questions you may have or help you with your giving as we continue to have services online. Church, let's be generous and give to those in need together. Give canned fruit and applesauce to Greensboro Urban Ministries pantry in June. Please avoid giving glass jars or breakable containers. If you would like to donate, drop your items off at our church office during the week or bring them to one of our outdoor services this month. We are excited to restart our Tuesday morning prayer time this coming Tuesday at 7 a.m. in the morning. We'll meet in the FLC at 7 a.m., so please enter the glass doors closest to the FLC. Our church has a special called business meeting Sunday, June 28th at 5 p.m. The meeting will take place outdoors, weather permitting. If not, we will meet in the FLC.
Do you want your life to make a difference? I know that many people think that in order to make an impact and for your life to really impact the world and to be successful, that one has to be smart or wealthy or to know a lot of things in order to make a lasting difference in the world. But you do not have to be smart, you don't have to be rich, you don't have to have great knowledge. But I will tell you that you have to be passionate about the great things that matter, those few things that really matter, and be willing to either live or die for them. Not everyone wants their life to make a difference. Many would be fine just to be liked, or to have a great job, or to have a great wife or husband and a couple of beautiful kids. They'd be okay with a nice house or a fancy car, a few close friends, a fun retirement, and a quick, easy death with no hell awaiting. If they could have all of that without Jesus Christ, they would be satisfied. John Piper says, that is a tragedy in the making. On May 20th, 2000, Piper preached his famous Seashells sermon at the Pastor's the Passion Conference in Memphis, Tennessee. He spoke that day. It was an outside service, and Piper had the opportunity to speak to 40,000 college students. In that message, Piper shared that 3 weeks before that day when he was speaking, two ladies from his church named Ruby Eliason and Laura Edwards had been killed in Cameroon. Ruby was over 80 years of age. She had been single all her life, and she had poured it out for one great thing: to make Christ known among the unreached, the poor, and the sick. Laura Edwards was a widow. She was a medical doctor. She too was pushing 80 and serving with Ruby. The brakes in their car failed and sent them over a cliff, and they were both killed instantly. Piper asked, was that a tragedy? Two lives poured out for one great thing: advancing the gospel among the poor. Two decades after most Americans their age had retired to throw their lives away on insignificant stuff in Florida or New Mexico or wherever. No, he said, that was not a tragedy that happened to those ladies. It was a glorious thing. He then said this to those college students. He said, I'll tell you what a tragedy is. And he read from an article in Reader's Digest dated February the 20th, 1998. In that article, it said this: Bob and Penny took early retirement from their jobs in the Northeast 5 years ago when Bob was 59 and Penny was 51. Now they live in Punta Gorda, Florida, where they cruise on their 30-foot trawler, play softball, and collect seashells. That, Piper said, is a tragedy. Friend, to come to the end of your life, your one and only life, and to let the last great thing you are proud of be, I collected shells. See my shells? That is a tragedy. I want you to take your Bible and open it, if you haven't already, to Galatians chapter 6. And let's look at what Paul tells us in verses 11 through 14 about focusing our entire life on the cross of Jesus Christ. He said, see with what large letters I am writing to you with my own hand. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh who would force you to be circumcised, and only in order that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. For even those who are circumcised do not themselves keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised, that they may boast in your flesh. Now I want you to pay attention to verse 14, because that's where we're going to concentrate this morning. Paul said, "But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." Now notice, Paul says, "Far be it from me to boast except in the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." That word boast can be translated exult in or rejoice in. In other words, Paul is saying only exult, only rejoice in the cross of Christ. Let that be your single passion, the one great thing in your life, your single boast, that which you find your greatest joy and exultation. Why? Why is that? Why should the cross be the one thing Paul would say to us to boast in? For this reason, friend, every good thing that we receive as believers is made possible only by the cross of Jesus Christ. Apart from the cross, one gets nothing but judgment. There is only condemnation. So everything the believer enjoys, we owe to the death of Christ. To say it another way, every blessing is meant to magnify Christ and Him crucified. If you are successful, there is a temptation to boast about what you have done. But when it comes to salvation, we had absolutely nothing to do with it. Jesus Christ needed no help to solve the problem of sin. So consequently, the believer is exhorted by Paul to brag only on Jesus. He alone is worthy of our praise. We are to boast only in Him and His cross. Here's what I want you to take from the message this morning. The greatest thing a Christian can do is to focus his or her life on the cross of Jesus Christ. Well, let's examine this verse, verse 14, and see why we should boast only in the cross. There's only one cross, the cross of Christ. But according to Paul, there are three different crucifixions. And I want us to look at each one of these crucifixions and discover what they mean to us. Let's begin with the first crucifixion. The cross removes the penalty of sin. Now go back, look what Paul says, very first part of verse 14. He said, "Far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ." Paul says he would only boast, he would only brag about the cross. That's an amazing statement when you think about it, because the cross was a horrible instrument of torture and execution. The Latin word for cross is crux. It means something important. We speak of getting to the crux of the matter. The really important thing, the cross is the really important thing in life. That's what Paul is saying. He is boasting in the cross. Why? Because the cross is the most important thing in life. But Paul wasn't boasting about just any cross. He was boasting in the cross of Christ. Remember, he was writing to combat the influence of legalistic teachers who had misled the Galatians into thinking that they had to become good Jews before they could become Christians. They were proud of their Jewish observances. They boasted about how religious they were. There are a lot of things that people boast about today. We brag about our kids. We brag about our grandkids, our houses, our cars, our investments, our football teams. People still boast about how religious they are. But friend, there is only one thing that we should truly boast about, and that is the cross of Christ. The Bible states that the penalty of sin in no uncertain terms is that we will die. Ezekiel puts it this way. In Ezekiel chapter 18, Ezekiel said, "The soul who sins shall die." So since we're all sinners, we deserve nothing but death and hell. But on the cross, Jesus, the sinless one, became sin for us. And he paid the price for the penalty for our sins. He became our substitute. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, "He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness." The scene was the Nazi death camp in Auschwitz, Poland. The year was 1941. Several prisoners had escaped. So in order to make an example, the Nazis randomly selected 10 prisoners to be herded into a cell where they would be starved to death. The name of a Polish Jew named Franciszek Gasifanaczek was called. He cried out in anguish, "Wait! I have a wife and children. What will happen to them?" The guards ignored him. Then another prisoner named Maximilian Kobe stepped forward. He said, "I'll take his place." Kobe, you see, was a Catholic priest, and he had been arrested for hiding Jews. So the soldiers grabbed Kobe instead, and they marched him into the starvation cell, and Kobe never made it out alive. A few years ago, NBC interviewed the then 82-year-old Franciszek. They followed him outside with the cameras and as he made his way to a tiny garden. And in that garden was a marble monument. And on the monument was inscribed these words, "In memory of Maximilian Kobe, he died in my place." Friend, that's exactly what Jesus did for each one of us. We are guilty and deserve the penalty of death and hell. But Jesus stepped up and said, "Father, I will take their place. Take me instead." Friend, that's the first crucifixion. The crucifixion of Christ. That crucifixion removes the penalty of our sin. But I want you to look at the second crucifixion that Paul mentions here, and that is the cross which resists the power of sin. Paul says, "By which the world has been crucified to me." Now here Paul is not talking about the world of people or the planet Earth. In the New Testament, the world, and that word is cosmos in the Greek, refers to the order of the evil world system ruled by Satan and his demons. It describes the general attitude and actions and the culture of people who reject God. So Paul says, "By which the world system, with all of its values, with all of its way of thinking, with all of its principles, has been crucified to me." The life of a person apart from Jesus Christ is the life of a victim of that system. Satan uses the world system apart from God to attract our sinful desires. But the Bible says in 1 John chapter 2, in verses 15 through 17, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desire of the eyes and the pride of life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away, along with its desires. But whoever does the will of God abides forever. Today, the world is still trying to draw us into its philosophy that says you don't need God. Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Friend, the world wants to make all of us conform to its fads and its fashions. We all feel the pressure to wear the labels that are currently in vogue. However, let me remind you that fads and fashions of the world come and go. But the Bible says, whoever does the will of God abides forever. Imagine you're in a really nice restaurant. You're sitting there with some good friends, and you're looking at the extensive menu. And while you're looking at the menu, you turn and you see a waiter approaching the table beside you. And that waiter is bringing a dessert called Death by Chocolate to one of those customers there at that table. That's a moist cake with chocolate layers and whipped cream on top with a cherry. And as you look at that dessert, your mouth begins to water, and you look at it and say to yourself, I'm going to have that. In fact, I'm tempted to order my dessert first. But for sure, I'm going to have that when I get through with my meal. And then you start ordering your appetizers, and then your meal comes, the main course. The food is delicious. You're enjoying the great fellowship. And before you know it, the waitress is back, and she has in her hand the dessert menu. And you open it up, and you remember that Death by Chocolate that you saw when you first arrived. And you find it in the menu. But suddenly, something happens. At that point, that dessert has lost its appeal. It makes you a little sick, in fact, to think about trying to eat it because you've lost your desire for dessert for a simple reason. You're full. You are totally satisfied, and you could not eat another bite. Friend, can I just say the temptations of the world are like that dessert menu? It advertises things that make your mouth water. You really want to try it, but when you are fully satisfied in Christ and the world has been crucified to you, you may look at the dessert menu, but you can smile and say, no thanks. I am quite satisfied. William MacDonald wrote, when a man is saved, the world says goodbye to him, and he says goodbye to the world. He is spoiled as far as the world is concerned, because he no longer is interested in its fleeting pleasures. The world has lost its attraction for him, because he has found one who completely satisfies. So the second crucifixion means I am crucified to the world. Because of the cross, I can resist the power of sin. I want you to look next at the third crucifixion here in this verse. The cross rejects the practice of sin. As Christians, we are not perfectly sinless. There is still sin in us. But the cross makes us hate sin the way God hates sin. Paul says here in the latter part of the verse, in verse 14, and I to the world. You see, not only was the world dead to Paul, but he had died to the world. There was nothing in the world left to appeal to Paul, because Paul was crucified with Christ. He wrote it back, if you'll remember, turn back a few pages to chapter 2 and look in verse 20. Paul said there, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, when Christ died, we died. When we are united to Him by faith, there is a union with Him so that His death becomes our death and His life becomes our life. What does it mean to be crucified with Christ? Let me try and explain it this way. There was a man who was literally crucified with Christ, the thief on the cross. As that thief hung there that day, he knew his life was about to end. He looked over at Jesus, who was bleeding and dying just like him. But this man looked at Jesus, who at this moment looked nothing like a king. But the thief said, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." That simple profession of faith was enough. Jesus said to him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Friend, when we're crucified with Christ, we'll be like that thief. He no longer cared about what people thought about him. He no longer cared about anything to do with this world, for he was about to depart it and enter another. Just imagine while he was being crucified with Jesus, a prostitute walked by. Do you think that that thief was interested in the least? No. He was crucified with Christ. Imagine a Roman centurion drove up in a sporty chariot. Do you think he thought, "Man, I'd like to have one of those"? No, he was crucified with Christ. Imagine a wealthy Sadducee was there wearing a mink robe with a velvet prayer shawl. Do you think that thief yelled, "Hey, where'd you get that outfit"? No, again, he was crucified with Christ. None of those things mattered to him any longer. The only thing that mattered to that thief was Jesus dying on the cross beside him, and he was dying as well and would shortly enter into heaven with Jesus. Friend, put yourself on that cross with Jesus. As you look into his eyes, you lose the desire to look at anything else. His death becomes your death. You have died to this world and its sinful ways. Back in 92, there was a young 18-year-old songwriter who was a pastor's kid who grew up attending church every Sunday. This young man loved the Lord, but he thought the music at church was awful. It was slow and sad. Hardly any of the young people ever sang. The young man finally complained to his father. He said, "Dad, the music at church is bad. When are we going to sing some new songs?" His dad said, "Son, if you think you can do better, why don't you write some new songs for church?" The young man did. That week he wrote two songs. The next Sunday, there was a mixed reaction to those new songs. Many of the older folks hated it, but most of the young people were inspired. So he kept on writing new songs. But I'm not talking about 1992. I'm talking about the year 1692. That's when Isaac Watts started writing hymns. Eventually, he wrote over 600 songs, including "Joy to the World." Watts based every one of his songs on a passage of Scripture. One of his most beloved songs came from this verse here in Galatians chapter 6, verse 14. We don't know it by its original title, which was "Crucifixion to the World by the Cross of Christ." See if you recognize it. "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and pour contempt on all my pride. Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God. All the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood." Watts wrote a third verse that we've never sung. I'm not sure why it was removed, But that third verse identifies the three crucifixions in Galatians chapter 6, verse 14. Listen to how it went. His dying crimson like a robe spreads o'er his body on the tree. That's the first crucifixion. That's Jesus's crucifixion. Then he said, then I am dead to all the globe. That's the second crucifixion. And then all the globe is dead to me. That's the third crucifixion. Friend, the cross is God's reminder that evil cannot win. The Romans put Jesus on the most despised symbol of the ancient world, a symbol of unspeakable brutality and death. But God transformed the cross into a powerful symbol of love and forgiveness. How do we respond to the cross? The last stanza of Watts's hymn tells us, were the whole realm of nature mine, that were a present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my all. So how can I become radically cross-centered so that all my rejoicing and exultation is traced back to the cross? The answer is, realize that when Christ died on the cross, you died. And when you trusted Him, that death took effect on your life. The old you is dead. A new you is alive. Paul reminds us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. And the new you is a you of faith. And what faith exalts in is not the world, but Christ, and especially Christ crucified. Friend, we are going to stand before God one day, the Bible tells us. And on that day, we will have to give an account. Don't make the mistake of spending your whole life chasing after that which is only temporary, that which is of no eternal value, only to be able to say, as you stand there, I collected shells. See my shells? Rather, spend your whole life focused on Jesus, so that when you stand before God, all you can think to say is this: my only boast is in the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, and to Him I owe everything. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank You today for the cross of Jesus. Lord, we know that without the cross, our lives would be empty, insignificant. We would be headed to an imminent hell. But God, we know that in love, in grace, in mercy, You sent Your only Son, Jesus, to come to this earth for the express purpose of going to the cross to die in our place. Lord, help us to understand that to truly know Jesus, to truly follow Him as Savior and Lord, is not only to accept Him into our life, but it's to die to our old life and to live the new life that we've been given through Him because of His sacrifice. So that when people ask us, what is your life about? What is it that brings you the greatest joy? We can say, my life is all about Jesus and the cross. It's only the cross that I can ever boast in. Thank You, Jesus, for loving us enough to die for us. For we pray it all in Your name. Amen. God bless you. Hope to see you again next Sunday on our campus. If not, I hope you'll join us again through video. God bless and have a great week.